Hello. I also want to say again, by reading Isaiah, I don't believe I'm a prophet. I mean, I might have the gift of prophecy. I do believe in the gifts of the Spirit, but I would rather be no prophet than a false prophet. And I mean, if I am a prophet, some of the things that kind of scare me, so I hope I'm not a prophet. But this is what I get from reading the scripture. This is what I get from reading the scripture and praying. So what I'm going to do in this part three is do Isaiah 58. And I'm going to do all of Isaiah 58 and talk in the middle. Shout it aloud, do not hold back. Raise your voice like a trumpet. Declare to my people their rebellion and to the house of Jacob their sins. And I mean, sometimes I feel that is, I mean that is what we as Christians should do. We should rebuke and people know their sins so they can turn back to God. And I mean, we are not Jewish. We are grafted onto the tree, but I think this still applies. For day after day they seek me out. They seem eager to know my ways, as if they were a nation that does what is right and has not forsaken the commands of its God. They ask me for just decisions and seem eager for God to come near them. Why have we fasted, they say, and you have not seen it? Why have we humbled ourselves and you have not noticed? Yet on the day of your fasting, you do as you please and exploit all your workers. And sometimes I think I'm too hard on fundamentalist Christianity. I can't judge what's in their heart. I can't. Only God can. But you can tell people by their fruits, from Matthew 7. But I do believe that deep down they love God and they think they're serving God, just like these ancient Israelites thought they were serving God, but they were not. Your fasting ends in quarreling and strife and in striking each other with wicked fists. You cannot fast as you do today and expect your voice to be heard on high. Is this the kind of fast I've chosen? Only a day for a man to humble himself? Is it only for bowing one's head like a reed and for lying on sackcloth and ashes? Is that what you call a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? And I mean, maybe as Christians, I think we don't fast enough. I mean, I've fasted a couple times, just a day, but the thing is we don't need to fast. I mean, we fast to show our love of God, and we fast to repent from our sins once if we stumble, or we fast to repent for the corporate sins of our nation, and I'm weak. I tried to do a corporate fast, and I could not do it. I was going to give up all sugar and all television for the year, and I succumbed and I couldn't do it. I still feel guilty about that. But we fight among each other. The left fights with the right fights with the left. Slanderous words, angry words. I mean, we are not trying to serve God together. We are not trying to work this out and trying to do what God wants. We're just calling each other names and we're just hating each other, and that's not what God wants. And, 6, is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen, to loose the chains of injustice and untie the cords of the yoke, to set the oppressed free and break every yoke? Is it not to share your food with the hungry and to provide the poor wanderer with shelter, when you see the naked to clothe him, and to not turn away from your own flesh and blood? And I mean, I am not the best at this. I try to be. I mean, I go with this as much as I deny it. But I mean, to systematically take social program to do things that hurt the poor and benefit the rich is not good. And I mean, whether, like I said, whether we can work, whether it should be the church or whether it should be the government doing this. But still, I mean, there are people suffering. And if the government can alleviate the suffering, should they not do it? Then your light will break forth like the dawn, and your healing will quickly appear. Then your righteousness will go before you, and the glory of the Lord will be your rear guard. I mean, and when I feel like I'm doing God's will, it does. It feels like He is behind me. He is pushing me on. And I like that feeling. Then you will call, and the Lord will answer. You will cry for help, and He will say, "Here I am." If you do away with the yoke of oppression, with a pointing finger and malicious talk. And that's what we have to do. We have to cut all this hatred speak toward. I mean, you can say, "I believe that this will bankrupt our nation." You can say that and point out why. But to call names and hatred, that's malicious talk. And that's bad. And if you spend yourselves in behalf of the hungry and satisfy the needs of the oppressed, then your light will rise in the darkness and your night will become like noonday. We live in a world filled with darkness, and that's why we are the shining light. Jesus commanded us to go forth, do good works, so the shining light will break through the darkness and reflect back on Him. But when people see Christians who don't seem to care, and who seem to be fighting for insurance for poor children, seem to be more in the pocket of big business, big insurance than actually they turn away and they say, "Oh, Christians don't care about anyone but themselves." The Lord will guide you always. He will satisfy your needs in a sun-scorched land and will strengthen your frame. You'll be like a well-watered garden, like a spring whose waters never fail. Your people will rebuild the ancient ruins. You'll rise up in the age-old foundations. You'll be called the repairer of broken walls, restorer of streets with dwellings. These two sections do not really apply that much to Christians. 13, if you keep your feet from breaking the Sabbath and from doing as you please on my holy day, if you call the Sabbath a delight and the Lord's holy day honorable, and if you honor it by not going your own way and not doing as you please or speaking idle words. Personally, I believe every day is a Sabbath day. I personally believe every day is the Lord's day. And so you try to die to yourself and try to live a life more worthy of Him. I mean, we'll never be perfect until we're with Him, but we have to keep trying, and we can't be blind. Then you will find your joy in the Lord, and I will cause you to ride in the heights of the land and to feast on the inheritance of your father Jacob. The mouth of the Lord has spoken. This tells us how to live. This, tied in with the Sermon on the Mount, tells us what God wants of us. And I do not see that in right-wing Christianity. I don't. And I know right-wing Christianity, they do a lot of charity work. And I know that. But the history of it is history of maliciousness. A history of business at the expense of the poor. And I'm not saying treat the poor at the expense of business, but you have to benefit the needs of the rest of the people versus just the needs of the rich and the elite. So, God bless you guys, and I hope this made you think.